Hello, ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to Exotic Astrology, and we are back with the Bhagavad Gita again. And today we are going to continue with the one of the longest purports of the Gita, which is the 12th verse of the second chapter. And here is this is the core essence of the Gita. Okay, in fact, the 11th verse of this chapter had placed one of the most important concepts of the body and soul, where Krishna said that while speaking learned words, you are mourning for what is not worthy of grief. Those who are wise lament neither for the living nor for the dead. So this was told by Lord Krishna to Arjuna when he was wondering how can he kill Drona and Bhishma. And Krishna told him that if you are wise, you should not lament, because the body will anyways fade off one day when the soul leaves, and the soul never dies. And now Krishna is going to speak about himself, and he's also going to speak about Arjuna and at a soul level in general. And from here the core essence of the Gita begins. And these verses which I am seeing, these are like especially the next four verses, you see, 12th verse, then 13th verse, then 14th verse, then 15th verse, and also the 16th, and the 17th. So these next five verses, these are the one of the most power-packed verses, and they are crazy amazing verses. They will bring you to the level of the soul, which means they will tell you about the soul and the conception of the distinction between the body and the soul and why we should not lament. So there you go, we will start now, 12th verse. And before we start, let us offer prayers to our preceptors. Om Agyan Timirandhasya Gyananjana Shalakaya Chakshurun Militam Yena Tasmai Shri Guruve Noah. Alright, and as usual, if you are new to the channel, then please subscribe to it. And if you have not watched the other videos of this playlist, then please watch it. Otherwise, you may be clueless of what I am talking here. And if you want a consultation from me, then please go down to the description section of my videos to my website. And yes, God is there with you all the time. Just don't look to him. Just listen to the verses and you will find him. All right. So in the 11th verse, we saw Krishna started speaking. And now we continue. So there you go, the 12th verse. Natvevaham jatu nasam natvam neme janadhipa nachaina bhavishyama sarve vayamata param. It's a very famous verse. The translation is as follows. Never was there a time when I did not exist, nor you, nor all these kings, nor in the future shall any of us cease to be. Wow. Would I repeat? Never was there a time when I did not exist, nor you. So Krishna is telling, I always existed and you also, Arjuna. Nor all these kings, means Drona, Bhishma, Duryodhan, Dushasan and Yudhishthir, all these. Nor in the future shall any of us cease to be, which means we existed eternally in the past, we are existing now and we will always exist in the future. Alright, now the purport begins. And I will try to finish this purport, but I think we will need two videos for this. Okay. Purport. In the Vedas, in the Katha Upanishad, as well as in Shvetashvatara Upanishad, it is stated that the Supreme Personality of Godhead is the maintainer of innumerable living entities in terms of their different situations according to individual work and reaction of work. That Supreme Personality of Godhead is also by his plenary portions alive in the heart of every living entity. Only saintly persons who can see him within and without the same Supreme Lord can actually attain to perfect and eternal peace. And there's a shloka now here again inside that shloka. Nityo nityanam chetanas chetananam eko bahunam yo vidadhati kaman tam atma sam ye nupashyanti dhiras tesham shanti sarvati netrasam. The same Vedic truth given to Arjuna is given to all persons in the world who pose themselves as very learned but factually have a poor fund of knowledge. The Lord says clearly that himself, Arjuna, and all the kings who are assembled on the battlefield are eternally individual beings. And the Lord is eternally the maintainer of the individual living entities, both in their condition and in their liberated situations. Period. So what's going on here? So in the first part, it is explained that how Lord is the maintainer. Lord Vishnu is the original maintainer of all the living beings. And this shloka is the Nityo Nityanam Chetanas Chetananam Eko Bahunam Yo Vidadhati Kaman. It's a very famous shloka. So Nityo Nityanam means eternally there are so many living entities. Chetanas Chetananam Chetana, yes, consciousness means living beings. Eko Bahunam Yo Vidadhati Kaman. So it is said here that Lord Vishnu is the maintainer. He was eternally, he is, and he will always be the maintainer. And that's the meaning of the word Narayan. Nara means all living beings. And Ayan means shelter. So Ayan is that which sustains you. So Narayan means one who sustains all the Naras. So Narayan, that's the meaning of the word Narayan. So the word Narayan has a very prominent meaning. And the word Vishnu means one who is present in every corner of the universe, every bit. Vishwa and Anu, these are two words by which the word Vishnu comes. And it is said here that the Supreme Personality of Godhead is the maintainer of innumerable living entities. Eko Bahuna. Bahuna means many. In terms of their different situations, according to individual work and reaction of work, which means depending on what we decide to do in this world and our pre-existing karma, our destiny. The Supreme Personality of Godhead is also by His plenary portions alive in the heart of every living entity. So whenever we get such statements in these purports, we should always try to think from where these statements are coming. So it is not that these statements are just coming out of nowhere. So whenever we find such statements, like this statement, let me repeat. The Supreme Person, that Supreme Personality of Godhead, who is that? That means the one who is maintaining that Supreme Personality of Godhead is also by His plenary portions alive in the heart of every living entity. So whenever we get such statements, we should try to see two things from where this could be coming. So for example, in the previous statement that the Lord is the maintainer of all innumerable living entities, it is coming from this statement, Nityo Nityanam Chetanas Chetananam Eko Bahunam Yo Vidadhati Kaman. So that we know. But now, where is this statement coming from? That Supreme Personality of God, it is also by His plenary portions alive in the heart of every living entity. This is there in the Bhagavad Gita itself. Lord Krishna says to Arjuna, that Ishwara Sarva Bhutanam Riddeshe Arjuna Tishthati. So this is coming from the Bhagavad Gita only. And now the second thing you need to figure out is what is the context of this statement, in respect to this current shloka or the shloka which was there previously. Okay? So for example, this Nityo Nityanam Chetanas Chetananam Eko Bahunam Yo Vidadati Kaman. What is the link of this shloka to this? That the Lord is in every living being's heart. Well, this means that the Lord who is in everybody's heart is only maintaining us. So without the Lord, we cannot even sustain. So the 400 Vishnu form resides in every living being's heart. So that's the connection. So he is the maintainer, and that is how he is maintaining, by being in everybody's heart. Okay. So that is why they always say, his words hit my heart. So they don't say that if somebody speaks very badly, rashly or harshly. We don't say that his words hit my brain or my mind. We say our heart, because the heart is the region where the soul resides. Soul means we, individually, we reside there, of the heart of this body. And Lord Vishnu also resides there, and that is how, from there, that is his sitting place, and from there he is maintaining the entire universe of this body, which means the body. Only saintly persons who can see within and without the same Supreme Lord can actually attain to perfect and eternal peace. So now, from where is this coming? Well, not exactly, but there are similar references to this. So, for example, there is this shloka, Brahma Bhuta Prasannatma na sochati na kangshati sama sarveshu bhuteshu madbhaktim labhate param. So, by this we can know this shloka which I said, Brahma Bhuta Prasannatma, why is this quoted in this context? Because here is written, only saintly persons who can see within and without. So that shloka says, Brahma Bhuta Prasannatma na sochati, means one who does not hanker and lament. Okay, one who is situated in Brahma Bhuta means in spiritual platform. Which means, spiritual platform means the person has completely realized that he is not this body, he is a spirit soul. So that person does not hanker or lament. And then it is said, Sama Sarveshu Bhuteshu Mad Bhaktim Lavate Param. So that is the time his spiritual life actually begins. So those people who can see within and without the same Supreme Lord can actually attain to perfect and eternal peace. So once the mind is fully under control, then we can obtain spiritual elevation. That is the beginning point, and that is the point where our spiritual life starts. So many people think that spirituality and mind control are not related, which means they think that you don't need to control the mind. You see, you can do whatever you want, you can do anything, anywhere, anytime, and still be spiritual. You know, you can just be divine and do divine things, divinities everywhere. So such illusions are there everywhere in so many people. So by this we know that it's written here, only saintly persons who can see within and without the same Supreme Lord can actually attain to perfect and eternal peace. So they are able to see the Lord within and without also. And this was the situation of Dhruva Maharaj, which is there in the Bhagavatam. And Dhruva Maharaj, he was meditating for 6 months at the Vishnu form, which is inside his heart. And after 6 months, that same form appeared as Lord Vishnu's personal form himself. And he himself appeared in front of him. So controlling the mind is very essential. Now, the same Vedic truth given to Arjuna is given to all persons in the world who pose themselves as very learned, but factually have but a poor fund of knowledge. The Lord says clearly that he himself, Arjuna, and all kings who are assembled on the battlefield are eternally individual beings. And that the Lord is eternally the maintainer of the individual beings, entities, both in their conditioned and in their liberated situations. So Krishna is eternally the maintainer of everybody in their conditioned state, which means the materialistic state, and liberated, okay, which is Nitya Siddha stage, as they call it, which means the soul has to be perfected himself. So that does not mean that we go beyond God or anything like that. Either we are in the material world or in the spiritual world, conditioned materially or spiritually liberated, we are always being maintained by Lord Vishnu himself. And that's why it is mentioned here, irrespective of their condition, which means in their condition and in their liberated state also. So sometimes people think that, oh, once I become spiritual, then I don't need God and I can do whatever I want. It's not like that. Okay. The Supreme Personality of Godhead is the supreme individual person, and Arjuna, the Lord's eternal associate, and all the kings assembled there are individual eternal persons. It is not that they did not exist as individuals in the past, and it is not that they will not remain eternal persons. Their individuality existed in the past, and their individuality will continue in the future without interruption. Therefore, there is no cause for lamentation for anyone. So basically, this means that Krishna always existed and Arjuna also always existed. And Arjuna is one of his eternal associates in the spiritual world. And he had also come with Lord Krishna before in another incarnation as Nar and Narayan, both of them. Nar, Narayan, Rishi, both two Rishis are very austere and they are very famous. And from them, Urvashi, the famous damsel of the heavens, the Apsara, she was born from these Nar, Narayan, Rishi. And the point here is that Krishna is telling that I am always the maintainer and I am always living, and so will you always live, and so will always these kings live. So essentially what Krishna is trying to do is, Krishna is trying to tell Arjuna that there is no need to lament, because these people will always be there. And if you are wanting that their bodies remain, well, the body will anyways die one day, because I said in the last video, the body is already dead. So it's like the dead body dies. So I give the example of the home, that if in a home or a house, you know, there are people are staying and they are maintaining it, then it looks as if the home is also a living body, but actually the home is not living. And similarly, when the people leave that home, that house, that room, then there are cobwebs, spiders everywhere, and the room appears as if the room is dead, but the room was always dead. So similarly, the human body is always dead. So the body never dies because it's already dead, and the dead body still dies one day. Wow. Confusing yet very simple. The Mayavadi theory that after liberation, the individual soul separated from the covering of Maya or illusion will merge into the impersonal Brahman and lose its individual existence is not supported herein by Lord Krishna, the Supreme Authority. So there's a very famous philosophy of Mayavad, which says that, once you become spiritually elevated, then you will be liberated and you will go and merge in some eternal existence, some eternal light, some Brahman, which comes out from God's body. But that's not true here, okay? Because the individual existence is always there. Nobody becomes impersonal. Everybody is an individual, and that personal aspect always remains. So losing its individual existence is not supported here. Krishna doesn't say like that. Nor is the theory that we only think of individuality in the conditioned state supported herein. Wow, fantastic statement. Very important statement. Point to be noted. I should repeat this statement. Nor is the theory that we only think of individuality in the conditioned state is supported herein. Which means many people think that, when I am in this material state, in this material existence, in this material world, then I have my individuality. And once I become spiritual, then maybe I will not have any identity. No, it's not like that. Our identity remains the same. Either we are materially conditioned or spiritually elevated. The individuality remains. So Arjuna at a spiritual level will always be different from Yudhishthir Maharaj or Bhim or Nakul or Sahadev or Bhishma Pitama. Okay, so all of them are different individuals. So just because they suppose a materialistic person, he perfects his life and he becomes elevated spiritually. So this does not mean that he will cease to exist or he will just disappear in some fancy land and he will stop to exist. It's not like that. So he will always remain who he is. The only difference is that his consciousness will be transformed. He will not have material desires. He will only have spiritual desires. But the individuality is always there. Nor is the theory that we think of individuality, only think of individuality in the conditioned state supported herein. Fantastic. This is one of the best statements I have seen. Because many times people think, if I become spiritual, I will lose myself. No, you will never lose yourself. You will remain who you are always. Krishna clearly says herein that in the future also the individuality of the Lord and others, as it is confirmed in the Upanishads, will continue eternally. Well, somewhere in the Upanishads it is said. This statement of Krishna's is authoritative because Krishna cannot be subject to illusion. If individuality were not a fact, then Krishna would have not stressed it so much even for the future. So everybody is an individual. So individuality is very important. And we always remain individuals. Either we are in the material or in the spiritual realm. And that's why Krishna is stressing. Krishna says there in the verse, you see, never was a time where I did not exist, nor you. So Krishna is referring individually, see, I and you, nor all these kings. The Mayavadi may argue that the individuality spoken of by Krishna is not spiritual but material. Even accepting the argument that the Krishna, that the individuality is material, then how can one distinguish Krishna's individuality? Krishna affirms his individuality in the past and confirms his individuality in the future also. He has confirmed his individuality in many ways. An impersonal Brahman has been declared to be subordinate to him. Krishna has maintained spiritual individuality all along. If he is accepted as an ordinary conditioned soul in the individual consciousness, then his Bhagavad Gita has no value as an authoritative scripture. So we will stop here. And the point which is stressed here is that Krishna said that in the beginning, if you read again, never was there a time when I did not exist. Means he's talking of the past, that he existed in the past. And later he says, nor in the future shall any of us cease to be. Which means he had an identity in the future. In the past, he has an identity now. And in the future also, he has an identity. So we cannot say that the soul will lose the identity. And we cannot say that, oh, Krishna is talking of material identity, because Krishna is not having a material body. His body is fully spiritual. It's Satchidananda. And if you say that Krishna is a material person, just like you and me, then there is no use of accepting the Bhagavad Gita. So the very fact that we are accepting the Bhagavad Gita, because it is a word of God, as the word Bhagavad Gita means the song of God. Gita means God, song, and Bhagavat is referring to Bhagavan. So this essentially means that we already accept him as God. And then therefore, when he is speaking of his identity and the individuality of others also. So this is where we will stop, and the remaining we will continue in the next video. And it's a very important verse which gives us a lot of knowledge on the individuality of the soul. So never think that you will lose your individuality. In fact, you will only gain your individuality more, because when you are elevating yourself spiritually, then what happens is we are regaining our original identity more and more and more. And then we will realize who we are really, or who we were, or who we eternally are actually. Because it's not that we were somebody and we are now and we will be somebody different later. We will always be the same person, but we will realize that more and more when we are elevated spiritually. Alright, so that is a very important part of the Gita, to realize that spiritually also we are all individuals and our individuality remains intact. Alright, so thank you very much for your patient hearing, and if you like this video, click the thumbs up and share it with others who is fearful of losing their individuality. And if you want a consultation from me, then please go down to the website down in the description section. And if you are new to the channel, please subscribe to it. All right. God is there with you all the time. Just look to him and you will find him.